Together, oh, this is just what heaven means to me. But what will it be when we get over yonder and we'll join the throngs around the glassy sea? We'll join our loved ones, then we'll crown Christ forever. Oh, now this is just what heaven means to me. And then at last, I'll see my blessed Savior, before whose image other loves all flee. And when they crown him Lord of all, I'll be there. Oh, now this is just what heaven means to me. But what will it be when we get over yonder and we join the throngs around the glassy sea? We'll join our loved ones, then we'll crown Christ forever. Now this is just what heaven means to me. I've been singing that song for the last 2 weeks in my shop. And you guys wouldn't sit down, so I thought I'd start with something new. Because we are teaching from the book of Revelations. And we are teaching about heaven. And we're going to be talking about one of the scenes that John saw in Revelation chapter 4. And then that is just the spinoff. That's the beginning. But let's take a minute now and open in prayer. Heavenly Father, I pray that your Holy Spirit falls upon us today, that you guide every word that I say, and that you will open hearts, and that you will unite us. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen. So we're going to start with Revelation chapter 4 up on the screen. And we're going to read through this so you get a glimpse. Now, Jesus has just talked to John and shown him what's going on with the seven churches. And then after these things, John says, I looked and behold a door standing open in heaven. And the first voice that I heard, like the sound of a trumpet speaking with me, said, come up here, and I will show you what must take place after these things. And immediately I was in the spirit, and behold, a throne was standing in heaven, and one sitting on the throne. And he who was sitting was like a jasper stone and a sardius in appearance. And there was a rainbow around the throne, like an emerald in appearance. And around the throne were 24 thrones, and upon the thrones I saw 24 elders sitting, clothed in white garments and golden crowns on their heads. And out from the throne came flashes and lightning and sounds and peals of thunder. And there were seven lamps of fire burning before the throne, which are the seven spirits of God. And before the throne, there was something like a sea of glass, like crystal. And in the center and around the throne, four living creatures full of eyes in front and behind. And the first creature was like a lion. The second creature was like a calf. The third creature had a face like that of a man, and the fourth creature was like a flying eagle. Now, this is a little parenthesis here. This is exactly the same image that Ezekiel saw. And he saw all of these same images, and these images now are likened unto the four Gospels. We have Matthew the king. We have Mark being the servant, the ox. We have Luke being son of man being portrayed, and John being the son of God portrayed. And that's these four images. So moving along, the four living creatures, each one of them had six wings, are full of eyes around and within, and day and night they do not cease to say, holy, holy, holy. And we've got to stop right there, because now we think back to Isaiah chapter 6, verse 3. Where Isaiah saw this same image. And in the Hebrew, when it has holy, 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 it specifically means that they don't have any way of saying, holy! Because in Isaiah, it says that the voice of him who said that, the seraphim, it shook the foundations of the thresholds of the temple of God. So that gives us a glimpse of the volume with which they were crying out. And so John sees this exact same thing here. And he said this, these beings were saying, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God the Almighty, who was and who is to come," which speaks of God's eternal eternity. "And when the living creatures give glory and honor and thanks to him who sits on the throne, to him who lives forever and ever, the 24 elders will fall down before him. Him who sits on the throne and will worship him who lives forever and ever, and they will cast their crowns before the throne, saying, 'Worthy are you, our Lord and our God, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and because of your will, they existed and were created.'" And so today, I have the privilege of being able to preach on this chapter. Do you have 6 weeks? And that's if we do it nonstop. We're going to focus on this last verse today. And so if you can just single that verse out and just keep it up there on the board, we're going to be talking about this and all that it infers. "For you created all things, and because of your will they existed and were created." This is the theological statement of providence. And I know theology scares a lot of people, but today we're going to talk about theology and the theology of providence and concurrence and worship. And you say, "Oh my gosh, that's so complicated." Okay, providence, God providing, that's easy enough. Concurrence, that's us agreeing with God. How simple is that? That's all we're talking about here. We're talking about God. Everything that God has created, everything that he does is within his will. Nothing exists outside of God's will. God has, as at last count, and this is my count, 51 individual attributes. And those attributes are what we're talking about here as being his will. He never acts outside of who he is. Absolute, everything that he is, everything that he does, everything that he has created is within that will. You realize that nothing takes God by surprise. In fact, we can say, has it ever occurred to you that nothing ever occurs to God? You get that? Nothing catches him by surprise. Everything is in his will. So as we move on through this, I got to get down here to my page. I want us to turn, if you have your Bibles, and I would recommend if you're going to come to church, bring your Bible. And it's really neat to hear the flutter of pages too, rather than the dinging of lights and such, all that kind of stuff. But anyway, Ephesians chapter 1, verse 11. "In Jesus also we have obtained an inheritance, having been predestined according to the purpose, according to his purpose, who works all things after the counsel of his will." This is Paul's way of saying the exact same thing that we just read from John, from the Revelation. I'm going to read it again. "In Jesus we also have obtained an inheritance, having been predetermined." And you think, oh, wait, are we talking about that Calvinistic concept of the sovereignty of God? Yep. That's what we're talking about. Predetermination, predestined, all of these terms are from God's perspective. Nothing ever catches God by surprise. Nobody comes to Christ or rejects him that he doesn't know about from time to time. God knows it all. Now, from our point of view, because we're not up there looking down, we're down here looking up, we don't know. We imagine ourselves determining that we looked for love in all the wrong places and we found Jesus Christ finally. We sought him. We confessed our sins. We accepted him as Lord and Savior. And that's just fine. That's our perspective. God's perspective is, I knew it all along. Nothing surprises me. So, having been predestined according to his purpose, who works all things after the counsel of his will. And this is providence. God provides. It's such an all-encompassing statement that nothing exists that does exist outside of God's will. And you all know Romans 8:28, which says specifically, for we all know all things work together for good to those who love God, who are called according to his will. So once again, God has predetermined these things. God has provided these things. And so providence is all working all things after his will. And so now as we expand this into a little bit bigger concept than just the salvation and Christian experience, we're going to look at creation. We're going to look at inanimate creation. We're going to look at animated creation. Co-caused events by creator, creation, and creature. Affairs of nations. All aspect of our lives, which includes the physical and the spiritual, which includes food, the number of our days, holiness, directed events, fortune, decisions, skills, and talents. All of these things come as a result of God's predetermined will. Nothing catches God by surprise. He has gifted us. He has created us. He has created everything. And we're going to take first thing, and we're going to look at a very, very normal thing that almost escapes our imagination all the time, and that is water. Have you ever thought of anything more normal than water? Do you know how complex water is? God created it. The evolutionists like to say that there was a big bang and out of nothing everything came and then it all started bouncing together and suddenly we had planets and outer space and then out of the primordial depths, but they never tell us where the primordial depths come from. It's water. Water, hydrogen and oxygen bouncing together somehow. No, God created. God created water, and do you understand its properties? It is the standard of liquid that everything else that we know on earth that is liquid is measured against. That's how normal water is. Did you know that water expands when it enters into its solid state? Absolutely everything else on earth, when it freezes, when it gets cooler, it condenses, it shrinks, it gets heavier. Water goes the opposite. Water gets larger. Water expands. Ice floats, doesn't it? Is that a surprise? Well, what is surprising is that, and aren't we glad that water doesn't freeze in our lakes and rivers and from the bottom up, because all of life that's in the water would then die. But water freezes from the top down because the ice floats, the solid state floats, and then it creates an insulation factor for everything that's below it so that all of life can continue to live until it thaws. Coincidence, huh? And then we talk about its gas state. It's when it evaporates. Where does the water go? It floats up into the air. And what stops it? Well, scientists have looked at, they found its tensile strength, its tension, its corrosive abilities, its absorption rate, its evaporative properties. When it reaches the stratosphere, water, for some reason, coagulates, turns into raindrops and falls back to the earth. What if it just continued to evaporate and continue to rise and didn't coagulate? It would get up into the troposphere where then the ultraviolet rays of the sun. That was a joke. Did you get that? The ultraviolet rays, okay, would break it apart. Hydrogen would go on forever beyond it. They would be no longer together. And because nothing creates itself, only God creates, we would not be alive here on earth anymore. We would have been gone a long time ago without water. Okay, now we look at the concept of the oceans. Two-thirds of our planet is covered with water in the form of oceans. And what is the most prevalent plant life in the oceans is the cyanobacteria, which we know as blue-green algae. And what feeds the blue-green algae? Sunlight. And this bacteria, this blue-green algae, turns that sunlight into carbon dioxide through photosynthesis and oxygen. It feeds on the carbon dioxide, and it gives off the oxygen, and we feed on it. So all of this plant life, God allowed, God created, God allowed the sun's rays, and we can get so complicated into this stuff, and I merely have read what everybody else has come up with, and we don't have time enough to go into it in great detail, but just understand, God created, and it's all for our benefit. Our moon, have you ever thought about our moon? If we look in our solar system alone, there's one or two planets that don't have any moons. The rest have multiple moons. Earth has one moon. And it is extra large by comparison to all the other moons that surround all the other planets. Why is that? If we take a look at the distance from here, because everything centers around Earth, that's where we are, right? Okay, so from our perspective, we look, and the moon, or the sun, is 93 million miles away, and the moon is 248,000 miles away. And the ratio of the distance is the sun is 400 times farther away from the Earth than the moon is from the Earth. Now let's look at the size of these two objects floating in the air. The moon is, 2,000 miles across, and the sun is a lot bigger. In fact, the sun is 400 times larger than the moon. Coincidence. From our point of view, we look up and we see the moon and we see the sun, and they're the exact same size. Is that a coincidence? Well, what happens when the two get together and the moon obscures the sun? What's that called? Total eclipse of the sun. Okay? What does that do for us? It allows the scientists and those that are interested to be able to study the sun. And when they can study the sun, they have come up with things beyond our imagination. And they have proved Einstein's theory of relativity, quite honestly. And they have looked at the rays, they've looked at the stratosphere, they looked at the rays that come off of the sun, the spectrum of the from the infrared to the ultraviolet, the spectrum of light that is emitted from the sun is akin to a deck of cards that stretches from here to the Andromeda galaxy. Okay, imagine that. That is the spectrum of the light that the sun emits. How much of it comes to us as sunlight? The plankton, the cyanobacteria, absorbs about 3 cards out of that deck of cards that stretches for unbelievable distance. Coincidence, isn't it? How do these things happen? Because God created. Now we talked just so briefly about the inanimate creation. Let's talk about animated creation. That's animal life, living animal life. Animals, insects, fish, plants, including their cycles of life, they all are necessary to our existence on Earth. We have the bacteria that we know that produces the oxygen through photosynthesis. And then God created a balance between the predators and the prey in the animal kingdom, the balance between the plants and the vegetation that the vegetation is the plants. Where's Dave Francis? Because I need him every once in a while to say, slow down, Carl. You're getting ahead of yourself. The animals that eat the plants, what are they called? Veterinarian animals? Vegetarian? Herbivores. That's good. I know they're called something. Thank you. So the herbivores and the balance between plants and insects and all of microbiology. And when we look at all of this stuff, how God created this balance simply so that we could exist here on earth, and we get to notice these things and we get to study these things only to be able to understand the complexity of who God is and his creative abilities. All of this stuff has come into play. And speaking of microbiology, can anyone here explain to me mitochondrial DNA? Okay, Clint raised his hand, he can. So if you want to know, go talk to Clint. This is the complexity and the minute complexity that God created. And in fact, when we, what's it called? Did I get a note on this? Irreducible complexity. Okay, this is what Darwin said. If my theory, because at the time, a cell was nothing more than a blob of a protoplasm. They didn't have microscopes to be able to break it down. But he says, if it turns out that things are too complex, then my theory is out the window. And that's called irreducible complexity, and that's exactly what we have. Even the smallest of all the cells that we know of that we're able to observe on this earth are so complex that there is at least 400 moving functions inside any cell. And for this to just bounce around and somehow evolve out of nothing is absolutely foolishness. So if somebody tells you that they're an evolutionist, you can go ahead and laugh because it's that funny. Absolutely impossible. I heard an argument here just very recently. Richard Dawkins broke it all down to, this is just, irreducible complexity. He said, if you don't understand how this stuff works, then you're just stupid. And isn't that a great argument? And this is what the other side normally does, is that they start calling names when they can't, when they don't have a background, when they don't have anything to balance, to base their theory on. They start calling you names. Anyway, moving ahead here, how about chance events? The way God works. Is there such a thing as luck? No. Nothing happens that is outside the realm of God's will. Okay, this is providence. This is him providing. And so back in the Old Testament, they had Urim and Thummim. How many of you are familiar with that? These were the stones that the judges threw when they couldn't come up with a solution. They threw the stones, they read them, and they made a decision. They were tossing the dice, knowing that God was controlling the dice, and the decision that they made based upon these stones, they would then, in confidence, offer their judgment. We can go on and we can talk about the atonement sacrifice, which I absolutely love. And in the atonement sacrifice, there were two stones that they put in the jar, and the high priest would reach in and pull those two stones out. One was marked for Yahweh, that's the name of God, and the other one was marked for Azazel. They would then go and take these two stones and place them on the head of the twin goats that were going to be a part of this sacrifice. And the one goat was taken in and slain. He was killed. His blood was then sprinkled on the mercy seat, while the other goat was then sent off into the wilderness. And this atonement was fulfilled in Jesus Christ, who shed his blood for our sins and sprinkled his blood on the mercy seat. And then in the other goat, he also took our sins as far away as the east is from the west. He fulfilled both aspects. And we throw in there also, the one who lives is also the one who dies. Okay? This is the picture of Jesus Christ, our Savior, our atonement. There is no chance. God directed every bit of this stuff. And then how about the affairs of nations? Yeah, history tells it all. That's all we can tell you. History tells it all. God is in control. I want us now, because we're looking at providence, which is what we just looked at, and now we're looking at the aspect of concurrence, our agreement with God. And I want you to turn in your Bibles to Mark chapter 4. It's Matthew, Mark, chapter 4, verse 26. And this is a little short parable that Jesus brings up here. And this is not about the second coming, and this is not about evangelism or anything like that. This is a parable about providence and concurrence. And Jesus was saying, the kingdom of God is like a man who casts seed upon the soil. And he goes to bed at night, and he gets up by day, and the seed sprouts and grows. How? He doesn't know. The soil produces crops by itself. First the blade, then the head, then the mature grain in the head, and when the crop permits, the man immediately puts in the sickle because the harvest has come. God created the seed. This is providence. God provided. Now comes concurrence, our agreement with God. The man tills the soil. The man plants the seed. The man goes through the whole cultivating process and waters and nourishes and gets the plant to come to fullness, to maturity. And then he puts in the sickle. He harvests the grain. He grinds the grain. He takes the flour. He mixes it with water and yeast. He creates bread. And he praises God. Okay? We agree with God that this seed, a creation of God, is for our need. And we have the Hebrew prayer. And this is looking at things. The Hebrews are not Americans. They don't look at things like we look at things. They look at it a whole lot differently. They see it more from God's perspective. And the standard Hebrew prayer is Baruch Atah Yahweh Eloheinu Melech Ha'olam Hamatzeh Lehim Min Ha'aretz. You want to repeat that with me? Blessed are you, Yahweh, blessed are you, Jehovah, King of the universe, who brings forth bread from the ground. God creates, we agree. We follow what we know is right to do, that he leads us. We do our part in creating this bread, but God is the one that ultimately has created it. Without the seed, without the grain, we have nothing. If God did not provide, we could not agree with him. And so then this takes us on to the next concept of everything in your life. Your work that you go to every day, your job that you do, your cleaning around the house, your buying the groceries, your putting together, your keeping the family together, your instructing your children. Every bit of this has been provided by God, and we do these things in living a normal, peaceful life because we agree with God. God leads, we follow. We are in concurrence with God. Take a look at 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 21. Is that right? 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 21. Now he who establishes us with you in Christ and anointed us is God, who also sealed us with the Holy Spirit in our hearts as a pledge. I'm going to read that again. Now, he who establishes us with you in Christ and anointed us is God, who also sealed us with the Holy Spirit in our hearts as a pledge. Okay, if we would look at Psalm 133, verses 1 and 2, it talks about the anointing oil that was poured upon Aaron, the first high priest. And it talks about how that oil fell down upon his head, ran through his beard, all the way down to the edges of his robe. Okay, we think today in America, when we anoint somebody, and I don't know that many of you have ever been around any anointing, but they take the smallest little vial of olive oil that they can find, and they put a little on their thumb, and they rub it on their forehead, and they say, this guy's been anointed. That's not the anointment of the Old Testament. They poured the oil on his head. They covered him with it. It flowed down. It flowed through his beard. It flowed all the way down to the edges, the hem of his robe. This is the picture I want you to see of the Holy Spirit, because he has anointed us and sealed us with this Holy Spirit, and it is a down payment of good things to come. When we look at the life of Christ, we see that in Philippians it tells us that Christ emptied himself of all his godly attributes. He emptied himself and took on the form of a bondservant. And then we get into the book of Luke, and we look here very quickly. At Jesus' baptism, the Holy Spirit came upon him like a dove. And Luke 4:1 tells us that Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led around by the Spirit in the wilderness. And this is for his temptation. And then we have Luke 4:14 that says, Jesus Christ returned to Galilee in the power of the Holy Spirit. And Luke 4:17 says, and he opened and found where it was written in the book of Isaiah, the Spirit of the Lord was upon me. And in your hearing, this has happened today. And so these are all the aspects of Jesus and the Holy Spirit. Acts 10 tells us, you know this Jesus of Nazareth, how God anointed him with the Holy Spirit. And Hebrews 4 says that how much more will the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without blemish, even after his death and resurrection, when Jesus entered into the temple in heaven, the Holy Spirit was with him. We're told in Corinthians, Paul writes and says, the Holy Spirit is with you. You've been anointed. You have been completely covered with the Holy Spirit. Act like it. Agree with God. And this ultimately is salvation. Okay? When God says you're a sinner, you say, you're right, God. We become Christians. We are now believers. It's just that simple. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. And you see how that starts? For God so loved that he gave. God provides, we agree, we concur, and we're saved. Now the Holy Spirit comes upon us, and so what are we doing? In our lives, in every aspect we do in our life, in our work, in everything that we do, we are agreeing with God that this is the proper thing. This is what life requires. We're agreeing with God. And in so doing, we worship God. Okay? So it's just as the Shakers, when they built their furniture, you guys all know about the Shaker furniture and such, that it's just really precise, perfect furniture, and it's highly valuable. And they built these chairs, they are so straight and so simplistic, and they built these chairs with straight backs so that they could be hung on the wall on the Shaker pegs to get them out of the middle of the room so that more work could be accomplished. You're not going to get anything done on sitting down. Well, that's my world anyway, right, Dale? In fact, I used to tell, I'm a carpenter. Okay, I ran a framing crew for 27 years. If I see you, and these are the guys that are working for me, if I see you on your knees, you better be praying for another job because you're not going to last here very long. I'm paying for you to be on your feet, and you're going to be working the entire time that you're on my payroll. It's just simple example of what the Shakers were doing. You're going to be working. And what are you accomplishing when you're working? You're worshiping God because you're using the talents and the skills and everything that he gave you. Jake, when you're up here playing that cool guitar solo, which really was good, okay, when you're up here playing, you are worshiping God in the very fact that you're using the talents that you have for God. And all of you women, Sue and all the rest that are up here loyally week after week, Saturdays and Sundays, and you're singing, you're using the talents that God has given you in honor of him, and you are worshiping him because you're using the talents that he has given you in respect to him. And every one of us, in everything that we do, you say, well, I'm just a housewife. Just a housewife? None of us guys could enter into such a thing and come out alive. Oh, my word. I thank God all the time that my wife does laundry. Horrible. In fact, even my cooking is horrible. But going on from there, every one of you and everything that you're doing, you kids that are in school, that are studying and learning, you are worshiping God when you're making an application of attempting to learn. Not just get by, but learn. This is providence, concurrence, and worship. And we're filled with the Holy Spirit. We have the enabling grace of God for when we get depressed, for when times get too hard, and we kind of in our minds get carried away by, because Satan doesn't leave us alone either. Okay? We have that aspect going on constantly. And so we're always under attack. And when we get done in doing everything, we think, all right, so 40 people came out the other night and they stuffed envelopes and they did all this nice work and everything else and they went home, and then it's time to relax. And then, oh man, when you relax, that's when trouble comes. Because, well, you know what, my wife, she hasn't been as friendly as and she, and well, my husband, he did, and then why is, and how come the kids are, and all these things start coming into play, and we start thinking and we start wondering, and Satan gets a foothold in, and the next thing you know, we've turned away from agreement with God, and we're starting to agree with Satan that really we are kind of like, you know, I'm a victim here. Don't relax. Stay sharp. Stay sober. Stay awake. Stay alert. The Holy Spirit has filled you, has been poured upon you like an anointing oil. Respond to that in worship, in obedience. Heaven's a wonderful place, filled with glory and grace. I want to see my Savior's face. Heaven is a wonderful place. Worthy are you, our Lord and our God, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and because of your will they existed and were created. Let's worship God with our lives, with everything that we do. Heavenly Father, thank you for our time together today. Pray your hand of blessing upon us. Draw us close to you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.